There is a common misconception that a wide-angle lens is the best for landscape photography. Some even labels a wide-angle lens as a landscape photography lens, which means that standard zooms and telephoto zooms are not. The idea is that since a wide-angle lens is covering a wide field of view, it can cover the wide vistas and take in the entire landscape. However, in many cases there are plenty of opportunity to use focal lengths longer than what a wide-angle lens can provide, or at least what falls within what a standard zoom can cover. You might initially think you want to use a wide-angle lens on a given scene because we've learned the myth that wide-angle lenses are landscape lenses, but I'm continuously surprised by how little I actually use my wide-angle zoom these days. No matter the kind of landscape, wide-angle zooms are not necessarily the optimal option. As you can see in these three photos from the same location, photographing the same waterfall with the same elements in the scene. A wide shot, a medium shot, and a telephoto shot. None of them photographed with a classic wide-angle lens. Two of them are photographed with a 24-105mm and one with a 70-200mm. Take another example from my day at Lyngby Lighthouse here in Denmark. I approached the area with my 24-105mm f4 lens, as you do with almost all scenes. 24-105mm is a very broad focal range from wide to a short telephoto, so chances are this lens can capture the scene in front of you. At Lyngby, the lighthouse was of course my focal point, so all my photography was centered on photographing the lighthouse among the lime grass covered dunes. I wanted to use the dunes as foreground to create depth and leading lines and visual flow towards the lighthouse. As many lighthouses in Denmark, this is a tall, slim tower, thereby not taking up a whole lot of space in the photo. If I wanted to incorporate a foreground without making the lighthouse very small, I had to photograph vertically, but even so I still had to zoom in as to not make the lighthouse too small. In these two examples, one photographed at 46mm and another at 63mm, the lighthouse in the 46mm photo is fairly small. One might think I could just move closer and thereby shoot wider. In my experience photographing these types of lighthouses, I know distance is key. The problem with getting too close is the distortion of the wide-angle perspective. This might work in nature, but for buildings it can be problematic. Adding distance, you look at the lighthouse instead of up at it, and you avoid the weird distortion. In this horizontal example photographed from the same distance as the previous photos, I had to zoom out to 29mm to include a near foreground. Besides one other photo at 24mm, 29mm was actually the widest photo I made that day, and you can see how much of the surrounding landscape I include. Yes, I really like the zigzaggy foreground and leading line leading up to the lighthouse, but the rest of the landscape is completely unimportant for the photo as a whole. It's actually pretty bland and boring. Imagine if I had photographed even wider. The two previous vertical photos are much more focused in what they show. Another photo, which technically is wide, is this one, but again photographed with my 24-205mm and also at 29mm with a slight crop. Here I again have a near foreground leading up to the lighthouse. A typical wide landscape photo, but the lighthouse is arguably quite small even though it stands out nicely. I actually didn't change the lens the entire day. The 24-205mm standard zoom lens was all I needed. Throughout 2019 I have also been photographing a whole lot more in forests, and not a single photo has been wider than 24mm. The reason for this is a wide angle lens simply includes too much from the scene. When looking at a photo, our attention tends to gravitate towards the brighter parts of the photo and especially the high contrast parts of the photo. Generally in forest scenes, the sky tends to be much brighter than the forest, and by shooting too wide you end up including the canopy, which is full of holes where the sky shines through. All those holes will end up distracting the viewer from whatever you are taking a photo of in the forest. Usually you would want to move a bit away from your focal point and zoom in, which is the same as using a longer focal length as to not include the canopy. Using a longer focal length also excludes a lot of the random clutter in the forest, which does not benefit the photo. Yeah, Mads, but these photos are all from Denmark. Wide angles are really good to take in the sweeping vistas in mountainous landscapes. Yes, a wide angle can work in mountainous landscapes for sure, but I've already shown one example from the Faroe Islands where I included a mountain in the background, but it was photographed with a standard zoom. Cicada in the Italian Dolomites is another example where a wide angle is often used to include a kind of foreground. My 24mm example here is not the best compared to many other gorgeous photos from this location, but there is no doubt in my mind I prefer this 46mm photo to the wide shot. Another example from the Dolomites is this 62mm photo. Again, the problem about photographing too wide is the risk of including too much of the scene you do not need. Photographing mountains, you generally do not want to make them look small. You want them to look big and majestic, and that is arguably easier if you do not include half of the sky above you. And here is another example from Sanoy in the Faroe Islands. Photographed at 24mm, you are simply photographing way too wide. The interesting part of this scene are the huge sea stacks in the middle, so the obvious thing is to zoom in. Bringing a human into the scene, it also helps emphasize the scale. You can surely get closer to the sea stacks, but shooting wider won't really help you much. As you can see on this drone footage, the sea stacks are just way too far apart and small for it to be an interesting photo. From Kalsoy, also in the Faroes, you can get this impressive view. However, you need a really long lens to get it, as a 16mm photo from the same vantage point looks like this. You can only just discern the cliffs in the background there. Even at 200mm, the reach is not enough. You'll actually need something beyond 400mm if you do not want to crop the photo to get this extraordinary perspective. You might think these are some very specific cases, but generally no. There are many places where you'd prefer to photograph with a focal length beyond 24mm. I'm not saying you cannot use a wide angle zoom in the Faroe Islands, you absolutely can, but it is not the only type of lens you can use to get incredible landscape photos. In Iceland it is the same deal. As an example, many glaciers like this impressive one called Fjallsalon are quite far away from the main vantage points. The default approach to photographing it would be to include all of it, but yet again it does not really work. The inclusion of the sky and surroundings makes the glacier look small and unimpressive. However, zooming in and using a longer focal length makes all the difference. And it's the same deal in this photo, which is photographed at 178mm. By zooming in and excluding the surrounding area, mountains and the rest of the glacier, I achieve a much more focused photo that only contains the parts of the scene I need to make an impact. Be sure to get my ebook about composition landscape photography if you want to know more about that subject. I cover all the basic principles of composition in an easy to understand format with tons of examples. You can get it down in the description, or also down in the description you can check out the free light version by signing up for my newsletter. Another argument for using wide angle lenses are exactly the ability to make impactful photos. The very wide view can create some distorted photos where it feels as if the landscape is being puked out into the face of the viewer. It has a very powerful effect and claims a lot of attention. I've already made a couple of videos on how to achieve this effect, and it is one I really like to photograph. There are some particular factors which you will need to work for to achieve a successful wide angle photo. These types of photos generally work fantastic on mediums like Instagram or in advertisement because they are so very impactful and draws attention. But as you just saw, you do not need a wide angle lens to make impactful photos. Actually, some of my most liked photos on Instagram the past half year are these photos. All photos that are highly impactful but requires a longer focal range than what a wide angle zoom can deliver. It is also important to note that just because something is highly engaged on Instagram or other social medias does not mean they're good photos in the broad sense. They might work for engagement on Instagram, but is an impactful photo that draws a lot of attention one you'd want to print and hang on your wall? That's a very important question to ask yourself, because if you do not want that, the dramatic wide-angle view is counterproductive to what you want to achieve. A strong depth is another argument for the wide-angle lens, but you can definitely create depth with longer focal lengths too. Here follow some examples. There is no doubt about the depth in this 42mm photo from the highlands of Iceland. Me posing in an adventurous style in the foreground, looking into the midground, which uninterrupted continues up into the background. Another highlands of Iceland photo is the 77mm photo. A rock formation in the foreground and the mountain in the background. When you look at a landscape, objects near you are almost always more contrasty than the background, so keeping this effect in your photos makes sure there's a natural understanding of the depth of the photo. It is very easy to see this effect in this 83mm photo from Gran Canaria. The trees in the foreground are very contrasty, but as we move into the midground rock and further into the background, there'll also be more and more atmospheric particles such as mist and haze between the camera and the mountains, which obscures the view and flattens the photo. This natural effect is very easy to destroy if you crank up the clarity too much in post-processing, because you want to show as many details as possible, so be careful of that. And just to drive the point home, here is another version of the photo from the Faroes. It is easy to get an understanding of the depth in this photo despite the very long focal length. I hope you do not take this video as a bashing of a wide-angle lens. I made it solely to dismantle the notion that the wide-angle lens is the best for landscape photography. I think calling a wide-angle lens a landscape lens is misleading and confusing. There are no best lens for landscape photography. There are best choices of focal length relative to the scene and your intention for the photo you want to catch. For many years my go-to lens was the 16-35mm, but the past year I've moved into the longer focal lengths. Not because I necessarily want to zoom into distant objects, but because it has opened up an entirely different approach to landscape photography and to see and show the world. Here follows a compilation of some of my favorite non-wide-angle lens landscape photos. One thing is to zoom in and out with your lens, and it'll surely help you to compose your photo. If you want to know more about composition in landscape photography, be sure to get my ebook. You can get the free light version by signing up for my newsletter. Both of them, plus my digital landscape photography maps, my Photoshop tutorials, are available via the link down in the description. Thanks to all of you who've already got one or more of my products. It is you who makes my job and these videos possible. If you enjoyed this video, I'd highly appreciate both a like and a comment.